So, this talk is about model syntax and semantics. And I'm actually very lucky that Runar gave his talk where he motivated all the whys. So I only have to deal with the what and the how, okay? So there is a whole bunch of whys behind it. I'm not going to repeat it, but I guess you will know why modularity and stuff like that is good. And in fact, I'm going to start with indeed introducing this great book of Runar and Paul. And my talk, oh, by the way, who has this book? Henny was started reading the book. Henny was finished the book. Okay.
I have to go back to some chapters.
Yeah. The point is that I'm going to give a talk that is inspired on chapter 13. I call it effects, or maybe more precisely external effects, I.O., right? And I've changed it a bit, right? So this is my interpretation of that chapter, right? And it's compatible with chapter 15, which builds on chapter 13. By the way, Runar also mentions chapter 14, if you remember from his talk, where he was talking about the how to deal with variables, internal effects. But this is about external effects and how to deal with them. And it is it's compatible with the last chapter, which is about streaming. The most important part is the effect part. Okay, a little bit of history about modularity of syntax and semantics. 1993, Java didn't even exist. I wrote a paper with Mark Jones about composing monads. And you could see it as a first attempt to modular semantics. 1995, there was an important paper in the Popple conference, Principles of Programming Languages, where also Mark Jones, together with other names like Paul Udak, maybe some of you know those names, did a better job by using monad transformers. It was still about modular semantics. That same year, by the way, the first one is just a report from the Yale University, because Mark Jones was at Yale at that moment, so, together with Paul Udak. 1995, I was at the University of Utrecht, and I did the first attempt to also talk about modular syntax using these beasts called catamorphisms. Don't think about them too much. But the whole idea of a modularity of syntax is that you would like to support a sum of things, but there is also recursion and how you deal with that, how you add something new to something which already has a loop, right? So that was the same year. This paper has never been published, but you can find it on the internet and it's cited a lot. Some more history. 2008. Wouter Zwierstra defined data types a la carte, which you could see more like a data structural approach to modular semantics. And in fact, in 2014, Runar presented an implementation based on those ideas in the Scala days, right? So once again, this talk is going to be talking about the last chapters of his book, together with the modularity that he describes in his talk, 2014 Scala days. So what's the difference? Well, the difference is that I'm not only dealing with monadic operators syntactically, but also with applicative ones. And I will talk about that in a moment. So, generally speaking, this talk is about the separation of, on the one hand, syntax, the description of programs, and I would like to emphasize here that we are going to describe them as data structures, right? It's our recipe on how to do things. It's not the first time this week that you hear this, right? And on the other hand, semantics, which is kind of the meaning of those programs, and it can be anything, that meaning. But often, but not necessarily, it will be an executable algorithm. But it can just be a transformation to other syntax or something, right? Can be anything. But the examples I'm going to show are, of course, just to show you something in executable algorithms. Effect. So more precisely, this talk is about the difference of effects. And effects are described by syntax. And side effects that are executed by program semantics, right? Then the real thing happens, okay? Make sense? A somewhat special quote from Linus Torvalds. You wouldn't expect a quote from him in a conference on functional programming, but read what is in blue. He prefers designing algorithms around data rather than the other way around. The next bullet is even a little bit more biased, where he says that the good programmers first consider data structures and afterwards algorithms. I'm not completely kind of in sync with that idea, but it's related to the fact that indeed your syntax should be data structures, okay? Okay, let's start with an introduction. I'm going to describe a type synonym here. The identity of Z is just Z. And think about it for the moment. In the middle of the talk, you have to change your ideas here. But think about it for the moment as a value in a box. Okay, it is not a value in a box, actually. I'm cheating. It's just a type synonym. But think about it as a value in a box. I could have defined it as a case class, then it was really a value in a box, right? By the way, everything I'm doing also takes variants into account, while in the book of Runar, there's no variants involved. But I found it interesting to actually introduce variants as well, which will play a role when we're talking about reactivity. I also like infix notation, so I'm going to define these two stars, so to speak, as an infix notation for products, right? So far, so good. And a similar thing for sums, okay? Because then I can use nice infix syntax. That's everything. But they are just the eater and the product which are built in. So, what is this talk all about? Well, about programs. And the remark of Martin Odersky on the book of Runar, I find it really very good. He says, this book gives you deep insights into the nature of programming. And I hope that at the end of this talk, you have a little bit more deep insight into the nature of programming. And I'm going to basically not say, well, the nature of programming, I'm not going to go deeper than this algorithm compared to this one. All right? So let me read this piece of code. And can I actually? Yes. No, I disable it now. So let me first evaluate this expression here. I'm not very good at using this mouse here, but to a result and bind it to Z, right? Then I'm evaluating this expression to a result and bind it to Y. And at the end, I kind of return. I don't like this name in the context of functional programming. Yield, maybe. I'm going to yield the result of evaluating that expression, right? Whereas here, I call here this is kind of a dependent composition of my program, because in fact my second line may depend on the first line in the sense it doesn't, that my Y could already depend on Z, because it's already in scope. See what I mean? Well, here, this is more like what I would call independent composition. I will evaluate both hello and lambda days to a result and bind Z and Y to it, and then for the rest it's more or less the same. And this is the essence of the difference between monads and applicative functors, by the way. Okay, so remember that. And it's about level of abstraction. Monads are, in a sense, not abstract enough, in the sense that the more they are more powerful, because they are more powerful because you can use Z already here, right? That gives you more power. On the other hand, it gives you less implementation flexibility. If your specification is higher level, you this independent composition, and I don't even think about semantics now, but you could think about semantics that is more clever. And what is the first thing that comes into your mind maybe here, that these two expressions could be evaluated for example, in parallel, okay? Just to mention one thing. But that just, I don't want to focus too much on sequential and parallel, although, of course, these are the examples I'm going to use. It's more about dependent and independent composition, right? Because there are many other semantical features which rely on dependency, yes or no. Everybody with me? Okay. So, by the way, since I can define this function plus, I can write the last one as follows, plus applied to hello lambda days, or, well, once again, evaluate both here to a result and then apply plus to it. Now, there is something strange about it, is that I read it from right to left. Okay, Chinese people don't have any problems with that. But there is something strange about it. But with a little bit of magic, a little bit of implicit magic, I could actually write it like this. Okay, so I'm binding the result of evaluating hello and lambda days to plus. And now I can really read it nicely from left to right. I'm just defining some implicit that does a trick for me. All right. Here's my main. And what's a little bit funny in my main is that I have these side effects here still explicit in my main, and I want to get rid of those. I want my main to be an expression. Okay? So I would really want to push the boundaries of expressions up to main, so to speak. That's the whole idea. So how to do that? Well, first of all, what are the words I've been using? Results. Evaluating to a result. I've talked about binding. I've talked about the end of the program. And I've talked about an end. And I'm going to make those things explicit. And once again, I'm going to do it for the moment only for, think about ID Z as a value in a box, right? It's a value in a box. It's not actually in a box, like I told you. So if I have a block of code, this is a by name parameter, I can put that block of code in a box and not evaluate it yet, right? That's the idea here. Let's start with the end. And it actually, since I'm not in a Scala conference here, I can give it another name as map, but it's actually map. So I can map a function from z to y to this value in a box to obtain a y in a box, okay? Makes sense? And the same for b and d, which is the flat map, where I have now a function from z to idy, but which results in an idy. And so what's the end all about? Well, I have two values in a box, and the result is two separate values in a box, and I have a box now with two values, right? That's what it does. Maybe some people have heard about another applicative functor because that's actually, well, or a monoidal category. I don't want to use difficult names here. But there are other applicative functor operators which say, like, I have a value in a box, a function in a box, and I turn it into a value in a box. So, but the basic thing is that you have two boxes. Take the values out of it and put them back in a box. All right? There are no boxes at all here because it's just a type synonym, so I don't even have to unbox and box those things, right? But just to give you the types are more important than the implementation here. Everybody with me? Right. So I really translated what I told you, results, binding, ending. In fact, the end is typically at the end. If you think about Scala for loops, the yield is at the end, right? So therefore I call it end. Okay, so using these things, I can now really write, read from left to right. I evaluate hello to a result and bind it to Z. I evaluate lambda days to a result, bind it to Y. And the result is the Z to Y evaluated, okay? And I just read it nicely. Okay, there is a little bit of overhead with the parentheses, but actually I prefer that over a for loop. Because you just read it from left to right, okay? The other one, and that's actually funny, you see, it's almost the same. The B and D becomes an A and D, and the Z Y is actually only visible later, right? Or I could switch to the E and D, and really at the end you yield, not you don't need a res anymore. You see, you don't need a res here anymore, so it's like yielding a value. And the same trick here, see, right? See the trick? That's the essence of the difference between monads and applicative functors. Can't say that enough, right? Simple. If you keep that in mind, I hope you already have some insight. This gives you insight. This gives me, at least, if I look at these insights into nature of computation. By the way, I can even write it like this. And I think it's a quality of your code that you don't need variables. All right, so they're away. Oops, I can do them away, okay? So I have the result of evaluating hello and lambda days, and I end with adding them, right? Isn't that nice? I like that. But we are not done yet because we still have these ugly things, right? So what is it what we really want? We want a println program. We want a println as being part of our program. What I really want to write is this. Now, be careful. This is a data structure. This is a recipe of what I want to do. This will actually only be a data structure that is a recipe of what I want to do. So this println is not a previous println, okay? But I call it println because it's just a convenient name. This is what the result of this is, a data structure, okay? Nothing fundamentally changed in the sense that I just concatenated all these things. I'm going to do a little bit of plastic surgery because all this binding is associative, so I might as well write it like this. And you actually recognize the previous one now. So you could also turn it into an end, right? See the mean? See that? All right? Is this too fast or do you see what is happening? All right? The advantage of looking at, from this way, a little associative difference is that I now can do the other trick. See? And I can replace the BND by an AND and just maybe have a recipe that I can interpret in a different way. Don't even think about semantics for the moment. It's just syntax, right? So now, what is the big difference between the book of Runar and what I've been doing here is that I made that END, the AND, sorry, AND explicit. I think that independent composition is such a fundamental aspect of program composition that I would like to make it explicit in the program syntax. I'm only talking about the gluing here, right? How do we glue things together? See, okay? Independently or dependently. And I think it makes sense to add the AND, the AND, to the core syntax. And not only the BND, right? My personal opinion. And once again, hey, that's a nice one. I can get rid of my whole thing because this case expression is a plus. And in fact, you see the case X, println X is just println. There's a little gotcha here is that I have to explicitly, because you will see everything will be parameterized over some embedded syntax. And what is the embedded syntax? The embedded syntax is actually the println. So I will parameterize over what is the embedded syntax I want to glue together, so to speak. Right? There is some embedded syntax I want to glue together with all these little combinators. And I will explain why the type inferencer needs that type parameter within a moment. So that's the only little bit unfortunate thing. So this will all be part of a huge class, so to speak, that has syntax as a type parameter. Still with me? More or less, I guess. So, what's the next step? I have my syntax, and I'm going to apply some meaning to it. I will explain everything, but think about some meaning function that somehow converts your syntax to semantics. Still nothing is happening, right? Still nothing is happening, but now I'm going to really do something. I'm going to execute that semantics. It happens to be, in this case, executable semantics. I'm going to execute that. And I'm immediately going to do that in a resource-safe way because typically if you are going to execute semantics, executable semantics, it might need resources. And the good news is what you don't see, namely that resource handling is done for you undercover. More about that later. Okay? So here it really happens. I could even have defined these expressions as lazy vols and evaluate them. And then my main were just four expressions. I'm not evaluating them because they're lazy, right? Okay, let's start with the end. So it's not the end of the talk, right? I'm going to define a few type classes, in fact, type constructor classes. And the first one is the map, okay? Think about end as map, yielding something. And it goes like this, okay? So it just lifts a z to y to an ez to y. And I'm going to say that e is of type end, all right? So my e type constructor is of type end. Think about it as map. Okay, I want to avoid those names, but it's a functor, right? The next thing, this object, don't think about it too much, but I will. It's very convenient to make those things implicitly available, and the simplest way to make them implicitly available will be by doing it via such an object. Now, the next slides will show a few laws, but of course I'm not going to show all laws always, but just to give you an idea, is that of course that you expect the identity to be lifted to the identity, right? We all know these guys, and you expect composition to be lifted to composition, right? And here you see how these implicits are used. Next step, natural transformations. And what is a natural transformation? A natural transformation is for a type constructor what a function is for data, right? So it's a natural transformation. A natural transformation will apply, will be applied to a value of type fz, kind of independent of z, to produce an h of z. And it's really kind of very independent of the underlying type z, in the sense that if I have any function from z to y, it doesn't matter if we first do the natural transformation and then lift it, or first lift it and then do the natural transformation. This may sound very abstract, but actually, in fact, it isn't. It's a natural transformation is natural. It's and our meanings will be natural transformations from syntax to semantics. And let me give one example. You could think of a natural transformation from list to option as follows. And by the way, look, I can define it as a vol. It's not a def, it's a vol, because, and I'm using this infix syntax. Think about it as follows. Well, if my list is empty, it's an option none. And if there is something in my list, I'm happy with the first element and put that in the sum. Okay? And this is nothing to do with, there is no real, well, it's completely agnostic of what this z is all about, right? So, for example, if I square my elements of the list, and I first square them, and then do the natural transformation, or the natural transformation, and then squaring them, it's the same thing. That's what a natural transformation is, just natural. Okay, it's really what you would expect. A few examples: the identity natural transformation.
Could we go back to this?
Excuse me.
One before. It's not like no. That was the. Yeah, exactly. We have a transformation should comes from the option to.
Yeah, but it's two times the same int here.
Oh, okay.
So it's not z and y. As you see, it's two times int. I agree. For z or the y. So there are on one hand you go from z to y. On the other hand you go from f to h. Mm-hmm. See, but it's two times an int. Okay. So there is a mapping of type constructors and a mapping of types. See, but it's kind of very type agnostic. It's like, you know, if I give you the type, I will give you type information. I'm going from a pair xy to a pair yx. Well, it's so natural that there is only one definition that can do that, swapping. You know, the types even impose the definition of a function of that type. That's a real extreme situation. But it's a little bit like that. You know, the types kind of guide you to what you want to do. There is only one natural implementation. That's, and therefore it's called natural. And that's what we're doing often. Eh? Very often we're using 0 and 1 instead of Booleans or something like that. Okay? Kind of, we think that's natural. All right, so it's a natural transformation. Identity? Of course they can be composed. I call it and then. Remember the sum? I can stick an f into f plus G. Now, this is a little bit of a difficult notation. I'm abstracting over this sum. So FZ plus GZ. I'm abstracting over that using a lambda. L stands for lambda. In Haskell, this there would be a more natural notation for this, but that's how it works in Scala. Okay? But, and by the way, general advice, only look at what I underline here. Don't be overwhelmed with the syntax, okay? But I'm just sticking an F into the left part of F plus G, right? And here the same thing. I can stick a G, into the right part, okay? And I will also need transitivity or recursivity maybe. I can combine them. Which I mean is that if I can stick an F into a G, and I can stick a G into an H, then I can stick an F into an H as well. Okay. Oh, no, it's a sum. This is a sum, excuse me. I can stick an F into an H and a G into an H, then I can stick a sum of bone in an H at the sum natural transformation. Stuff like that, okay? And remember that I was talking about the problem of modular syntax. This is all about these sums, right? So I'm going to add more and more syntax and try to deal with them using those tricks. Don't even look at the definitions. Just listen to my talk. Subtypes. A subtype is a natural transformation, probably with extra laws, but it's just a very special type of transformation. And of course, every type is a subtype of itself. I can stick a J is a subtype of F plus J, and here is this transitivity, sorry. So if F is a subtype of J, and J is a subtype, excuse me, if F is a subtype of J, and am I just right, then I can also consider it as a subtype of J plus H. Okay, so the F is actually a subtype of this one, and I put it and by combining this one with the left here, this left side, I can recursively define subtypes. Okay. Even if it's, but I think you can imagine this, right? Can recursively define subtypes. It has nothing to do with polymorphism, subtyping in the object-oriented sense. It's really like parts of being part of. Okay, let me start with programs. And in fact, again, for those who really want to know the categorical thing, these are these kind of free monads. But I'm just going to call the program. No, there's not the free monads yet. They will arrive. These are just the programming features. Excuse me. So the programming features are, well, like I always said, res. And res is a natural transformation from the identity to R. Now really think about the identity not as a box anymore, just a value. So res means I can put a value in a box. And now in this case, R is the box, right? I can put a value in a box. That's a computational feature that I want. I call it res from the result, right? And if I have a value in a box and another value in a box, now I'm really defining it in the most general way by also abstracting over A. I have two values in a box, right? Don't even think about the other one. Then the bind, well, I can do the binding, right? If I have a value in a box and a Z to BY, then I can actually lift that to this, right? That's a monadic bind. If you don't care about this value, we are only concerned with this value, then I call it bind underscore, because you see, it's constantly giving me back by. And there's another thing. There is a join, which is a val, which is a, be careful for the syntax. Don't look at the syntax, just listen to what I'm saying. It's a natural transformation from BB to B. That's what it is. And it's the same as concatenating a list of lists together, right? So if I have a list of lists, it becomes a list, right? And it can be defined in terms of the things which already exist. And in fact, also the opposite, which we will see soon. But I, it's more natural to think about binding. All right. So what are the programming features that we will need? Well, all the ones which I've been talking about, the END, the REST, the AND, and the BND. Okay. And there are a few default definitions. END can be defined in terms of BND and REST. AND can also be defined in terms of BND and REST. But that's the default definition which I want to override. That here, actually, polymorphism plays a nice role. Object orientation plays a nice role here because this is the default one. I may be happy with it, but maybe exactly because AND is at a higher level of abstraction, I have more flexibility for implementations than just this default one. Make sense? And so on. And you see that even the BND can be defined in terms of join. So actually join and rest and END and end are also primitives that give me the same power. And so this is now a monad, right? Okay. Sorry for the difficult words. But that's my gluing. I have three things, rest, putting it in a box, and then two boxes, getting values out, put them in another box, and then the two types of continuations.
So
yes?
Let's say that to be in sync with that, what was written by Runar, RES is just a unit.
Yes. Okay, yeah, RES is unit, excuse me. RES is unit, end is end, and it's not used a lot in his book. He has map2 and stuff like that. So he combines it immediately. He takes those two values and immediately maps the functions to it. So he uses map2. But I actually use it's something which is more primitive than that. So he has map and map2 and map3 and so on. But of course, if I have an end, I can also, it's kind of tupling, right? And so my BND is like in Haskell, but it's really binding rather than flat mapping, in my opinion. And I like the name end because it's what you do at the end. At the end of a for loop, you yield a value. Really, very often you keep on binding, and you end with your value. That's really what you do very often.
Let's say when in Runar post it was like apply. I mean, they define something like that in.
There is an apply as well, and that's the app. But I will answer your. Is it okay that I answer questions at the end? But it's true. There is an app which is kind of what I was telling. Like I have a value in a box, a function in a box. Take both out. Compute result and put it back in a box.
Yeah.
Okay. But basically, the whole idea is that for that it's more abstract because I have two things in a box. The two things are abstract, are put in a box.
Mm-hmm.
While for the monadic binding, I have a box, but the other thing is really a function. Not a function in a box, but really a function. Okay, it returns something in a box. But it's less abstract, okay? So to that extent, monads are not abstract enough. That's what I want to claim in my talk, okay? All right. So, what is this thing? Well, we are object-oriented programmers, right? So for the moment, I've only defined functions, but of course, we want to use those things infix. And these are the infix versions, right? So if my P has all these nice features, I can also use them infix. That's what this code says. Forget about it, but that's really what it says. So I'm now looking at this from an infix point of view, from a methods invocation point of view, right? Of course, the rest, the unit, and the join are not part of it because I don't have an object to apply to, all right? Unit is a factory method and join is a kind of joining method, right? Okay, now we come to program syntax. And these are what you would call, free monads. What's the idea here? I have embedded syntax. Remember this special thing I want to glue together? I want to glue things together, syntactical features together with the things I've just defined. Think about my println, which is somehow part of this program. The only requirement is that syntax should be able to yield a result. That's the only requirement. And in fact, this program syntax is a program, has all the programming features. So program syntax has all the programming features. Only look at what I'm underlining. And Syntactically, there are only three possibilities. Once again, this is the one I'm adding. So either I have a unit, a result, I have the bind, two monadic ones, but I'm adding this end here, right? Right? So these are the three cases. But these are data structures, okay? It's like a list or a tree. I'm building up these data structures, right? And so here's my embedded syntax, okay? Which I stick into a result, basically, which I put into a box, because I don't want to evaluate it yet, right? I only want to describe it. Like, for me, it's more important that you follow my reasoning than looking at all the code. Make sense? Now, in which way is this a program? Well, really, like, I'm just, in a way, in the free, most free way that you can think of. My operators will actually be built data structures. My rests will be build a rest program, you see? My end will build an end program, and my bind will be build a bind program. So this is the most free way in which I can actually interpret this thing, right? I'm just building this thing up. So this kind of the most simple semantics you can attach to those things, right? But it's not it's just kind of, we're still building up a data structure, so to speak. What's the semantics? Now look at the requirements. Remember that my syntax should be able to return a result. My semantics has a requirement to support all programming features. In fact, it doesn't. If you look at it carefully, it doesn't need the rest. The rest is on the left. But anyway, I'm writing the PRG anyway. The complete, the end, all the things, all the gluing things, all the basic computational features that I described in my two first simple programs. But the rest is not needed. Now, assuming I'm using this infix syntax a lot because I like it. Assuming that I have... Oh, by the way, I see something. I'm going to regenerate the slides. Just a second. Is it here? Yes. Because I was not consistent with my names. Escape. Where is this thing? All right. Open. If you don't mind, I'm going to take this one. Try 64. All right. You see, I was not consistent with my names. And while I was, during the previous talk, I changed my, I'm generating this because this is my actual code. Eh? I'm generating this LaTeX slides. So I let me now just do the presentation again. Right. So, by the way, you know, as long as something is a type parameter, I'm using these cryptic names. But the real stuff, I give it a real name. That's the reason. But okay, what are the requirements? My syntax should be this, and my semantics should be this. Now, I'm assuming that for my embedded syntax, think about this as the embedded syntax, I have semantics. So if the things I want to glue together, I have semantics for that, then I also have semantics for my complete program syntax. That's the whole idea here. So, sticking all these things into, gluing them together with my primitives, and the semantics of those primitives can be lifted. And just to mention one why here, you remember that Runar was talking about the benefits of defining different semantics. Maybe for my test, I can do testing semantics and stuff like that. The whole idea here is that, well, in many projects, you see that the real code and the testing code, they live different lives. But I'm testing the real code here, right? By just attaching other semantics. That's the idea, right? If you remember this, it's also a good thing to remember. You're testing the real code by just attaching testing semantics. Okay, here is the semantics. And it's really what you would expect. I'm actually defining it here as a lazy val itself so that I can recursively call it. Well, if it's a REST program, well, it's just the semantics of the embedded syntax. So if it's embedded syntax, it's just the given semantics of the embedded syntax. Otherwise, it's the end of the semantics that recursively combines them, or it's the bind of the semantics that recursively combines them. And if now you look carefully, I don't need the rest. For the semantics, I only need the A and D and the B and D. I'm always interested in how much do you really need. There is a reason why I have used PRG anyway, which I will explain later. So really, you cannot think of an easier definition of this. This is really the types tell you the definition, believe me. You can't think of an easier definition. Okay, what's the next thing? Now I have sub-syntax. Remember, think about I want to support println, readLEN, these kind of things, all kind of external effects, maybe connecting to a socket or something. I'm adding them all together. But all these things, I want to define them really in a modular way. So if I have a sub-syntax of the real syntax I want to support, I can lift it to my real program syntax. That's the whole idea here. The only look at the underlining things. So all my syntactical components, which I've glued together, I can actually lift them to the real program syntax. That's what this lifting here does. Okay. Did I mention program resources? Yes. So I'm going to deal with program resources for once and forever. Okay. So let me define what a program resource is. What could you expect? You can probably acquire it, and you can probably release it, right? Make sense? Now, I would like to execute something that depends on a programming resource in a resource-safe way. And I'm trying that, because that can fail. Maybe resource is not available, right? Now, don't again look. In fact, I'm not using the try. For those who know about the try in Scala, I'm not using that one. I'm using the one from the Book of Runar. And I've added a little bit of syntactic sugar. So let me first look at this here. I'm trying, well, so assuming that I have my resource, I try to execute the resource, and in any case, I release it. So this should look familiar to Java people. Who knows about Java here? Well, or has programmed in Java. But look at those backticks. They are methods. They are methods. But I just do a little bit of magic so that it looks like it's really a try finally. I like that idea. And I had another method, which is trying, which is actually a try finally without a finally, where the finally is just doing nothing. But I was obliged to give it another name. Because you also need to try to acquire your resource in the first place, but you don't need to do a finally here. But, well, this code will deal for once and forever with resources. That's the idea here, right? Okay, I've been talking about executable semantics, right? So some semantics is just might simply be a syntactic transformation or maybe a compiler. Compiling it to bytecode or something like that. Here I'm talking about really like more like an interpreter, right? Which should be executable. And what does it mean for something to be executable? This thing. Given a resource, I would like... So my thing is executable. If giving a resource, I can obtain a result. My result is completely abstract. My resource is completely abstract. But of course, I want it to be... the resource type constructor needs to have the properties which I just described here before, right? And then I can, and now you see the resource save exec, which I used in the beginning, is just doing the resource save exec from the previous slides. Do it for once and for all, okay? Do that for once and for all. Can't say it enough. So some things that have programmatic features, for example, your semantics, can also have executable features, so I'm combining both. Just think about the combination of programmatic features and executable features. I'm in the reactive track, so I have to say something about reactive programming. Well, remember that everything was covariant, but I'm going to introduce something here which is contravariant, namely a callable thing, a piece of code that you can call, right? Right? It's the opposite of something that you kind of pull. It's something that's pushed to you and you do something with it. Okay, that's the introduction. Let's start now with the real syntax and semantics. What syntax? What's the kind of syntax? What is syntax? The kind of thing I would like to plug into those programs. Well, it has two incarnations. The active syntax, which is just a z, a value z. But of course, it's not a val, it's a def, right? So it's a by name value, so to speak. And it has a reactive incarnation, which is the, you can think of this as the dual of the value. And the reactive incarnation is the bidual, okay? The bidual, so I go from z to unit, again, to unit, twice, okay? I do that twice, make sense? See, basically, I'm calling my callable. And there is, of course, I can implement reactive programming in an active way by just passing the value to that callable, right? So think about the first one. In order to get your value, you have to pull it. The second one, it's pushed to you. And you the pushed value, with that pushed value, you call that pushed value. But once again, mathematically speaking, it's just a bidual. Okay, the dual twice. Okay, twice doing arrow to unit. Make sense? And it's covariant again, but intermediate it was contravariant. Okay, so what is the simple semantics I can attach to this kind of syntax? Just immediately evaluate. And you really have to read it from left to right. It's the semantical result of letting the syntax do its thing, of letting the syntax act. Of course, I'm going to also talk about future semantics and stuff like that, or maybe testing semantics, but this is just the simple semantics you can think of. I'm going to read it again. It's the result, it's a semantical result of let the syntax act. Okay? I can't kind of think about something simpler than that. I've already defined simple syntax, namely the this is my simple syntax I can think of, the identity syntax, which is just a value. And this is the way you put that value into this thing. Well, it's a case class, and that's the way. Don't look too much at the code, but I put it in a box. Here, it's just putting it in a box, right? It's putting a value in a box. That's my identity syntax. My identity semantics is basically the same thing. But of course, I can play with different things. I can already define this thing, and this is the only thing I regret in my whole code, is this instance of. Okay? In order to not repeat, I'm using this syntax a lot, but I have to use an instance of for the moment. Okay? Identity semantics is also a value in a box. Okay? But I want to start simple, but it will become more difficult later. So now I can finally write my println program details. Remember my program, which was just result of hello, bind it to z, result of lambda days, bind it to y, and eventually z plus y bind it to x and println it. But the println was just syntax, right? First of all, I need a print writer. And I'm going to consider that as a resource by wrapping it into some thing which I call the print writer programming resource. So this is how I acquire. Well, I acquire my print writer as just a console writer, and I release it by closing it. You see, I will. So in order to kind of reuse this resource save exec, all my resources will have to be instances of such a thing, right? All my concrete resources, I will wrap them into something so that I have my acquire and my release. Does this make sense? I also have my println syntax now. This is my println syntax. It's really like printing this string and flushing the print writer, but it's not doing it. Really, it's really not doing it in an active way. It's just kind of something you get in a box, right? It's encapsulated in this box. So I can, for example, for testing purposes, test this by completely ignoring this thing and making logging what needs to be done, all right? I can completely ignore it. Somebody went to the talk of Lars Huppel about he did something. He actually also defined a separate data structure for this, which is, and then he called Koyoneda magic and stuff like that. Don't want to talk too much about it. But here is the simplest way of putting what you want to do in a box. This is a smart, this is kind of lifting this thing as program syntax. So Runach calls this in his book a smart constructor. And this is actually my println. It's a constructor. It's constructing that data structure. Right? My semantics.
Excuse me, I think we're running out of time.
It's already out of time? 5 minutes?
5 minutes ago we were out of time, so I think
okay.
It's good time for questions.
All right, so, well, just 1 minute then. 1 minute, okay. So I have my println syntax, same thing. And now here I'm doing the real thing. The syntax I want to support is so my identity syntax and println syntax. My semantics is the sum of the two semantics. And that's it. All right. I had to say that my effect, my syntax should support res, but it just takes the one from the identity. So the result of the identity is lifted to the level of effect. And here we go. My meaning is my prog syntax meaning. And my resource save exec is the one from my identity semantics. Now, okay, that's the end of the story. But I can use that for using sockets in an active way, in a reactive way, and stuff like that. Okay? So I only used it for this simple, for kind of making println part of my description of my program rather than doing it in main. But you can think of it for all kind of things: reading from sockets, writing to databases, whatever you want. And the good news is that what you don't see, namely that the databases will be closed for you, well, or maybe the connections will be given back to a pool, rather stuff like that. Okay. That's it. Okay. And also remember, then maybe some questions, is that the real difference between the book is that I make this end explicit. So I kind of make explicit in the program that I want independent composition. That does not necessarily mean that I have to interpret it in a parallel way. Because, but of course, the intention, I make explicit in the program that it's independent composition and that I may be able to attach future semantics to it so that it runs in a parallel way. So please, if you would like to see kind of, maybe this was high level, but if you go to the book of Runar, these are the last chapters. And you will kind of see this is a kind of resume of what is written in his book. Thanks so much. If there are any questions, please feel free to ask. And thanks so much for staying so late.
Okay? Good speech, but I have to catch my
train. No, if they have to catch trains or planes, no problem. I'm here to ask questions.